Good morning, afternoon, evening. Dear Congress President Yong Kim, dear Program Committee Chair Wolfgang Weiss, dear Professor Vañó, and dear colleagues. It is indeed a great honour for me as the ERPA President to introduce this term's Sievert Award lecture. Firstly, let me remind you of the context of this most prestigious award. The Sievert Award and lecture, to be presented at each ERPA International Congress, is made in recognition of outstanding contributions to radiological protection, which honours the memory of a leader and pioneer in our profession, Professor Rolf Sievert. The recipient of the award must be preeminent in the discipline with a professional reputation second to none. Nominations are made by the ERPA Associate Societies, with the winner selected by a prestigious panel of former ERPA presidents, Sievert awardees, and other members of the great and good of our profession. This year's awardee was nominated by the Spanish Society for Radiation Protection, who selected Professor Eliseo Vañó as their candidate. Clearly a wise choice. Professor Vañó now joins this list of exceptional personalities in radiological protection after a life dedicated to radiation protection in medicine and medical physics. Professor Vañó is Emeritus Professor of Medical Physics of the Department of Radiology of the Complutense University of Madrid, where he was the first full professor of medical physics of all Spanish universities, and promoted the creation of the medical physics expert degree and the centralized radiation protection and medical physics services in Spain. For 34 years, he was head of medical physics service at the San Carlos University Hospital in Madrid and nominated advisor of the Spanish Ministry of Health for Radiation Protection. He has had many distinguished international roles, having been a member of the Euratom Article 31 group of experts and a member of the Spanish delegation to UNSCEAR. Until 2017, Eliseo was chair of ICRP Committee 3 on Radiological Protection in Medicine, where he led the elaboration of numerous key reference publications since he joined the committee in 2001. Currently, he is emeritus member of the main commission of ICRP. For more than 25 years, Professor Vañó has been a consultant of the IAEA for topics concerning medical exposures and has been involved in missions in many Latin American, Asian, African, and European countries. He has contributed many of the IAEA training packages for radiation protection in medicine. Professor Vañó has led more than 30 research projects, 15 of them funded by the European Commission, mainly dealing with image quality and patient and staff dosimetry in medical imaging and interventional radiology. He authored more than 300 scientific publications included in the Web of Science. He is an honorary member of the Spanish Society of Medical Physics, the Spanish Society of Vascular and Interventional Radiology, and the Spanish Society of Radiological Protection. He also received the Barclay Medal of the British Institute of Radiology in 1996, and the International Union for Physical and Engineering Sciences in Medicine Awards of Merit in 2018. The topic of his lecture will come as no surprise to you. Why is radiological protection different in medicine? And I would now like to invite Eduardo Gallego, as ERPA Vice President, to present Professor Vañó with the ERPA Sievert Medal, following which Professor Vañó will deliver this prestigious lecture. Thank you.
Well, it's a great honor and a great pleasure to have the opportunity to give this medal or the Sievert Award to Professor Eliseo Vañó. Please, Professor, the applause.
Society of Radiation Protection. Thank you, Eduardo, and thank you also to the Ricardo. Thank you.
Well, the title of my lecture is Why is Radiological Protection Different in Medicine? First of all, I would like to give my thanks to IRPA for this honor to receive the Sievert Award 2020, to the Spanish Society of Radiation Protection for my nomination, to the ICRP. I have been 16 years and 8 years chairing the Committee 3 in ICRP. But also to IAEA, WHO, PAHO and ANSCIAR to allow me to cooperate with these international organizations and to learn from them. To all my colleagues and good friends from Spain, Complutense University of Madrid and San Carlos University Hospital, in Europe, in Latin America, and many other countries in the world, to have shared many hours of my work and of my life, and very especially to my family, to my wife and my two sons. Who is this conference for? For all the professionals interested in radiological protection, not just for those interested in medical exposures, and also for patients. All of us have been or will be patients in some moments of our life and have been or will be exposed to ionizing radiation for imaging or for therapy. I will try to summarize the ICRP recommendations in medicine, referring to the reports published, the scientific impact of those reports, the quality to prepare or to produce the reports, and the follow-up that it can be done for the reports of publications of the ICRP. And later I will refer to why radiation protection is different in medicine, no limits for the patients, the justification in three levels for the medical exposures of patients, and optimization, considering the two instruments, diagnostic reference levels and trigger levels for some of the interventional procedures. I will also refer to the staff and patients for the point of view of justification and optimization. And finally, to look for the impact in ethical issues and the education and training of patients in and information, training and information of patients. Well, concerning the current impact of ICRP in science and in medicine, just to remember you that, as you know, Committee 3 is the committee, one of the four committees of the ICRP dealing with radiation protection in medicine. And I have tried to group the, in periods of 10 years, the publications of the Committee 3. And in the last 20 years, ICRP has produced 22 reports. And on the right, you have also the percentage of the reports published by Committee 3 in comparison with the total publications of the ICRP. And in the last 20 years, this percentage has been between 32 and 42%. ICRP has published since 1959 a total of 146 reports. The ICRP reports published by the Committee 3 are dealing with diagnostic radiology, interventional radiology, nuclear medicine and radiotherapy in percentage quite similar in the four areas of activities of the use of ionic radiation in medicine. And you have the titles of these 22 reports in the slide. And I have also looked for the ICRP citations and the impact in the different scientific areas in the Web of Science. In total, there are 4,621 publications referring the ICRP reports. And you can see in the graph in the lower part of the slide that in the last 15 years it has been an increase in the number of citations relevant. And the most cited publications, the most cited publication has been ICRP, the publication 105, entitled Radiation Protection in Medicine, with more than 1,700 publications. And if we look now about the different scientific areas presented in the Web of Science, the 18% of the publications referring to the ICRP reports are in the two areas, the nuclear science and technology and the radiology, nuclear medicine and medical imaging. And later, 16 and 12% are also in the public environment, occupational health, and the environment science ecology. Then ICRP is more and more referred in the different scientific areas of the Web of Science. I would like also to commend the quality of the reports produced by the ICRP in comparison with the referee system we have in other scientific journals. As you know, in the scientific journals, usually when we submit a paper, it's previously looked by the editor and later are nominated two or three referees to give the opinion and to make suggestion to improve the paper and finally is published. If we compare these methods with the method of the ICRP, I feel the method of the ICRP is really relevant and transparent to confirm the quality of the reports produced. The ICRP, before producing a report, is creating a working group with 5 to 6 experts. Later, once this working group, usually with 2 or 3 years, prepare the report should be approved by the full committee, in our case, in medicine, the Committee 3. For approval, once it's approved by the committee, it's going to the main commission of the ICRP with 14 experts, and the main commission should approve or introduce or suggest some changes before going to the open public consultation. That's a period of 2 or 3 months. The report or the draft report is uploaded to the website of the ICRP, and any expert individuals or scientific societies or medical societies could do comments to improve the documents. one, this period is finished, the document is going with all the comments to the working group again. The document is improved and again is gone to the committee for approval, to the main commission, and the final approval is finally done by the ICRP main commission. Then in total there are these six steps just to guarantee that the quality of the reports produced are good enough. But it's not only that. For questions of transparency, also the draft published for the public consultation is maintained in the ICRP website. The draft and all the comments done by the societies or by the individuals, and then it is possible to compare the last version of the published documents with the previous version of the draft before receiving the comments and before the last improvements of the changes. And all this information is available at the website. Also for the past documents, and you have in the slide example of the one of the documents of Committee 3 about diagnostic reference levels. The number of registries in the website is only the number of societies of experts giving the comments, but you can look in the content that in our case for this report, from 28 registries, there were more than 300 comments that has been taken into account to produce the last version. Well, I will try in my talk about the radiological protection in medicine and the difference with the other areas of radiation protection to address the question of the limits, the non-existing limits for patients, the three levels of justification is differencing the justification in medical exposure in medical for patients in comparison with the other areas of radiation protection, the optimization with a priority for the clinical outcome. In the number four, I will refer to the patient and occupational protection as an integrated approach. It's not possible in some parts of the medical exposure to establish a clear difference between protection of the workers, of the medical doctors, and protection of the patients. And finally, I will refer to some of the ethical issues for radiological protection in medicine, but probably will be considered in the coming document on radiological protection in medical for ethics, and the ethical and training in radiation protection for professionals working in medicine, and the relevant part about information of radiation risk and benefit for the patients. Then there are three levels. In the third level, I will talk about the limitation, justification, and optimization, but with the specificities for patients. In the second level, I will refer combining some aspects of justification with the optimization when considering the occupational protection, because the evaluation should be integrating the protection of the patient and the protection of the workers. And in the last level, in the third level, because all these parts will converge in the ethical issues in radiation protection in medicine, and in the education, training, and information on radiation protection. Information for patients, because patients should be informed, as said, by for the benefits and the risk of ionizing radiation. Concerning the medical exposure is not only patient's exposure, is also including comforters and carers and volunteers for biomedical research. For patients, there is no dose limits and no dose constraints following the recommendations of the ICRP, but for comforters and carers and volunteers in biomedical research should be applicable dose constraints. The ICRP defines the patient as an individual who receives an exposure associated with the four parts of the three parts of medical practice: diagnostic, interventional, or therapeutic procedures. Therapeutic procedures can be done by therapeutical specialists in therapy, but also in some services of nuclear medicine. The ICRP dose limits and dose constraints are not recommended for individual patients. In this case, the emphasis is therefore on the justification and the optimization. And for the optimization, ICRP has recommended also to use diagnostic reference levels, and in some cases also trigger levels that we will refer later. Those constraints are applied for visitors to patients and families at home. And one example of this kind of dose constraint is the value of 5 millisieverts recommended in ICRP 103 and 105 for this kind of visitors or some of this kind of families having at home some patient after the release of therapy in nuclear medicine or other kinds of therapies. The volunteers in medical research also have dose constraints. And in ICRP 105 on radiation protection in medicine, it said that the volunteers as part of the biomedical research provide no benefit for the volunteers. But it's not always the case, because in ICRP 62, also dealing with volunteers in medical research, it's said that this kind of volunteers could be also patients, and in this case of the patients, the ethical committee should consider also the benefit and the risk, and in the it should be noted that in the category 3 of the research programs may involve effective doses higher than 10 millisievert. And then this should be probably be addressed in the coming document of ethical issues, because it's not exactly one situation in all the cases where the volunteers participating in the research programs are not with direct benefit. If they are patients, they could have direct benefit for the treatment of the diagnostic of the pathology. We move now to the justification and the three levels of justification. Justification of radiological protection of patients is different from the justification in other radiation applications. The benefit is in this case for the patient. The patient enjoys the benefits and suffers the risk also of the exposure in a procedure using ionizing radiation. For example, one procedure that considered as justified as one computed tomography examination is not necessarily justified for some specific pathology or some specific patient. And in this case could be considered, other options are magnetic resonance imaging or echography, and this should be the decision usually of the practitioner. Should be noted that when we refer in justification and in optimization with ionizing radiation, we refer to radiation detriment. And in the medical area, the detriment, the health detriment, could be coming from other aspects and not only for radiation. And this should be taken into account when using the justification and the optimization criteria. The three levels of justification are the first general level, the proper use of ionizing radiation in medicine, and that is accepted. Currently, there is no discussion that the use of ionizing radiation is used and with a large benefit in diagnostic and in therapy for patients. The second level is referred to one specific procedure. For example, computed tomography is today considered as a general imaging technique very useful for diagnostic imaging in medicine. But we need a third level to apply one specific imaging technique or imaging modality to individual patients. And this third level for individual patient is very important, because this is the clear situation to address one individual patient and to consider the specificities of the patient, the specificities of the pathology, and in sometimes also the psychological aspects of the patient, if the patient need or expect to have one specific examination. The patient and occupational exposure both should be considered in justification. The principal aim of a medical exposure is, of course, to do more good than harm to the patient, but the radiation detriment for the exposure to the radiological staff, usually it could be in some examinations with very close to the patient and other individuals, as stated in publications the number 103. Then it's important, or it's relevant, to consider that the staff should or may be considered in some aspects of the justification. The effective dose is a radiological protection quantity, but could be used also in justification and could be used also for comparing different diagnostic procedures. The use of effective dose for assessing the exposure of patients has, notwithstanding, several limitations, and there are large inaccuracies when we do the estimation of effective dose for specific patients, and this should be also taken into account when using this quantity. We will refer to that. For example, if one patient has a CT examination and they receive some information about the dose, the radiation dose employed by the X-ray system to do the image, the information is presented in milligray per centimeter. But if this patient could have another examination, an interventional procedure in cardiology, one angioplasty, for example, the result, the dose imparted to the patient, or the dose used by the system, is expressed in grays per centimeter square. And if these patients could have another procedure in nuclear medicine, the information received is the activity of the radiopharmaceutical in megabecquerels. And to explain the patient what is the radiation risk, considering with the three examination with different quantities, is quite difficult, and this for that we have software and we have possibilities, conversion factors, to estimate organ doses and effective doses in millisieverts to combine the relative radiation risk for the different examinations. This is one of the main practical aspects to be used with effective dose in information, in giving information to the patients, just to convert or to combine or to explain what are the relative risk of the different examination concerning the radiation risk to the patients. ICRP is producing a new document on the use of effective dose as a radiological protection quantity, and this document will have one specific chapter dealing with the use of effective dose in medicine. And the public period of consultation has been finished in August 2018, and 58 registries with comments has been received. You can look at the comments and the opinions of other scientific societies and several experts in the website to look at their points of view different from the presented in the draft report of the ICRP. In the chapter of the use of effective dose in medicine of this draft, I have highlighted six aspects that for me are especially relevant. One is the use of effective dose for comparing different imaging modalities, the way to explain the relative radiation risk for the patients. Other is for risk communication, because individual risk for the patients, individual radiation risk, is quite difficult to estimate, because not all the details, the situation of the medical situation of the patient, the anatomical details of the patient, but effective dose could be used also for approximate the risk communication of the patients. For justification could be also useful, just to know that these patients have had or could have another previous examinations. But the uncertainties is one aspect to be highlighted. Then he said that in several publications that the uncertainties in the estimation of effective dose also for this standard person could be about 50%, 40-50%. And this also used effective dose, or could be used with care when the one specific organ or part of the body for the patients are irradiated. For example, is not practical to use effective dose for mammography examinations or for repeated examinations and in some part of the patient, the cerebral angiographies or examinations. In these cases, it's much better to use or to estimate organ doses and to work with organ doses. Then the progress in the use of effective dose in the coming years could improve. It has been published a recent paper by Colin Martin, John Harrison, and Rehani, members of the ICRP, presenting the effective dose with some of the limitations, but also in the future. And I have highlighted two of the main limitations also presented in the paper is that the effective dose is calculated for reference phantoms or average individuals, not for specific patients. And the consideration of the age of the patient should be also taken into account. 1 millisievert or one examination with CT that typically for one patient could be 10 millisievert is not the same if this is for a child of 10 years or for an adult of 30 years or for an adult of 70 years. The risk of 10 millisievert is different because the radiosensitivity of the patients is depending on the age and the gender. But newer techniques is also included in this paper allow improved calculations because more and more is managing anatomical phantoms. The phantoms could be used for different ages for the patients. The effective dose could be personalized for the different sizes of the phantoms. And then it is expected that in the future we could manage much better with the effective dose and the calculation with the effective dose. But the general consensus, at least in most of the authors, is that effective dose should be not used as an estimator of individual doses for patients, because also the risk detriment should be, but in comparison with the other detriments from the pathology of the patient. Another relevant topic in the recent years in the literature is the recurrent images procedure on the same patient. And then it has been in some of the last publications reported that patients having more than 100 millisievert could be in the reports published between 3% and 4% for computed tomography and interventional radiology for some groups of patients. And this could be useful to have this information for referrers and for practitioners. For referrers to look to the previous examinations and to look and see if the selected coming examination is really necessary considering the preliminary examinations, and also for optimization. When this information arrived to the practitioner could look if part of the information has been already obtained previously. And now to have information about the recurrent imaging procedure is or could be relevant to refine the application of the justification criteria or to reconsidering part of the justification criteria for some group of patients. And it's also convenient that the dose management system could give alerts about these high doses in certain patients. High doses usually giving information about the kind of procedures and giving information about the information obtained about the diagnostic of the procedure done previously. All this information could also help the practitioners probably to modify the protocols and to improve the optimization during the procedure. The optimization in medicine is different from the optimization in general application of ionizing radiation because the priority is mainly the required medical objective. And in some of the medical examinations, the doses, the radiation doses to the patients could need to be increased if the quality of the images, of the diagnostic information, where we are managing multiple images, are not enough. And then it's clear that the comparison with the general use of optimization having the priority for the required medical objective is one of the particularities of the optimization in medicine. Also, if we compare radiation therapy with diagnostic procedures, the optimization is different inside medicine, because in radiation therapy, the intention is to irradiate some organs, the target with a certain dose, but to protect the other organs and the other tissues. And in diagnostic procedures, the intention is to obtain good images, to obtain a good diagnosis, and the radiation should be reduced as much as possible. But having the priority in the image, if the image is not enough, we need to increase the radiation dose to the patient. And this has been highlighted especially for the pediatric aspects, and in one of the last reports about radiation protection in pediatrics, it said that the dose should be the minimum necessary, but to achieve the required medical objective. The medical objective is or should be the priority in any medical use of a radiation. Some examples of optimization in imaging, some particular examples could be, for example, could be to compare the situation of one procedure when one obese patient with one standard patient. And you have in the image the images of two of the test object in a standard patient on the left and in an obese patient simulated with thickness of polymethyl methacrylate. On the left is 20 centimeters of polymethyl methacrylate simulating a standard patient, on the right with 35, and you can see that the image on the right is degraded. Then this image should be improved doing one clinical procedure, and this improvement could require higher dose, could require higher QVs in the X-ray beam, could require higher filtration, and this of course is more dose for the patient and sometimes also more dose for the staff. But this optimization should be, or this protocol used with obese patients should be particularized. Also, when we refer, for example, with the imaging of the stents, use these stents to maintain open some arteries, and if we obtain a direct image with the stent, the acquisition, you can see on the left that the quality of the image is very poor. But with the new technologies and with new post-processing protocols, with the same dose or increasingly slightly the dose, we can obtain a much better image quality. And this could be necessary just for the good positioning of the stent. And this is also one of the examples that the optimization in medicine should be very specific for the clinical protocol. Well, this is one example of the application of trigger levels. This corresponds to one patient with a complex procedure in cardiology in our San Carlos University Hospital in Madrid. Once the procedure was finished, it was estimated that the peak skin dose was 13 grays, and that clinical follow-up was decided. And in fact, the dermatology service was contacted in order to do the follow-up of the patient. And 14 days after the procedure, it was this skin injuries presented in the paper. The follow-up by the dermatology service was done. And after approximately 3 months, the injury was solved by the dermatology service, and it was a good example of the clinical follow-up, and with a moderate additional workload for the staff and a good satisfaction of the patient. And this is one of the cases demonstrating that it's necessary to apply the trigger levels, it's necessary to inform the patient and to establish this kind of clinical follow-up. The patient and occupational protection as an integrated approach is one of the other aspects to combine the justification and the optimization. This was highlighted by the ICRP in the publications in the report published in the year 2018. about radiological protection in interventional procedure. And this is one example of one interventional room. Sometimes the interventionalist should be very close to the patient. And sometimes the saline suspended screen is not possible because the interventional radiologist should be managing on the patient. And in these cases should be taken into account that the scatter radiation dose could be quite high in the moment of the acquisition of the images. We have arrived to measure 430 millisievert per hour, and this is a high dose rate, and this should be known by the interventional radiologist in order to reduce as much as possible this kind of imaging modalities or to use protective shield. And this is relevant especially after the new limit of occupational dose for the lens of the eyes, especially for this kind of interventional procedures. ICRP has published one specific document about radiation protection in interventional radiology, and this has been highlighted that too often dosimeters and protective lead glasses are not worn, in some cases for complexity of the procedure, in other cases because it's not used. Interventionally should take it some responsibility for their own personal radiation protection, because radiation protection experts maybe not during all the time helping them or alerting them about what are the situation, the critical situation, and this should be included in the education of this kind of professionals. But electronic occupational dosimetry may be also part of the dosimeter. If interventionalists could have this kind of external dosimetry over the apron, information about the dose rate or the occupational doses could be in one screen inside the catheterization rooms, and the interventionalists could be alerted that they are receiving very high doses. The real risk for opacities, for induced opacities in the lens of the eyes has been demonstrated in the literature. Some of the programs of the IAEA in the Latin American Congress of Interventional Cardiology, and these are data from the SOLASI Congress in Buenos Aires in the year 2010, have been obtaining values of 50% for interventional cardiologists and 41% of the nurses and technicians working in interventional radiology having lens opacities derived for a lack of radiation protection. This group of cardiologists and nurses are voluntarily attending the evaluation of lens opacities during the celebration of the Congress. This is not an open sample, but it is quite worrying to look that this high percentage of professionals are not using enough radiation protection during many years. This is one example of cataracts, a subcapsular posterior cataract compatible with the injury of radiation detected in one of the professional with a level of opacity of 1.5. It's a real cataract produced by interventional professionals working after 22 years without the proper radiation protection. And this should be avoided in the future. If we compare the situation of the level of exposure to the lens of the eyes 20 years ago with the current level of exposure, is a different of a factor practically of 10. On the left you have the image of one interventional cardiologist receiving also measured at the San Carlos Hospital, measuring at the lens of the eyes about 300 micrograys per procedure, and currently the level of dose per procedure is approximately between 20 and 40 micrograys or microsievert per procedure. We have arrived to reduce, with the good use of the saline suspended screen and lead glasses, more than a factor of 10 of the radiation dose. IRPA has performed several surveys to evaluate what could be the situation with the new lens of the eyes, the limit for the lens of the eyes. And I have highlighted three of the aspects relevant also in the medical applications, is the determining the need for routine monitoring for some groups of professionals, the need of additional education and training in relation to this protection of the lens of the eyes, and the changes in the health surveillance of the workers, especially interventional radiology professionals. This is one of the benefits of the recommendations of the ICRP to avoid the relevant number of opacities in the lens of the eyes on some of the professionals. The ethical issues in radiological protection in medicine is another of the important aspects to be considered in the coming years or to be reinforced, especially in medicine. ICRP in the publication 105 refers to the protection of the staff and protection of the patients to be considered together. And this involves several ethical issues, giving the priority to some of the aspects when we have this kind of complex interventional procedures, and also the resources applied to the protection of the medical field. Sometimes if we select one kind of procedure or one kind of installation to perform some procedures and we have not in our resources applied, the level of protection could be decreased. And these have reference or importance in the ethical aspects. The five of the ethical set of values highlighted by Professor Maloney, one of the last publications, the dignity, the non-maleficence, justice, prudence, honesty, and solidarity, is the first, the dignity and the autonomy is relevant for workers and patients. And as Professor Malone highlighted, is applied typically for workers, but less for patients. And this could be one of the aspects to be taken into account in the coming document of radiation protection on ethics in radiation protection in medicine, is the personalized criteria for radiation protection. Sometimes patients are, or patients with a certain age, are accepting an additional radiation risk to confirm one diagnostic, one cancer diagnostic, or one just to view or to verify if some of the preliminary examinations are confirmed or not, or to obtain more quality in the diagnostic. And this information might involve a relevant psychological benefit for the patient. And this should be also considered from the point of view of the justification or refine the justification. This coming document for the ethical aspects will be produced by the task group 109, and there are relevant scientists as members of the working group. Now it's in preparation, and this expected will be the second publication of the ICRP dealing with the ethical aspects in radiation protection, in this case addressed in medicine. And finally, the education and training in radiation protection for professionals, including information for patients, is one of the relevant aspects to be taken into account also. ICRP has published one document highlighting the need to include the radiation protection in the medical schools and in the dental schools, and not only for the training of specialists during the residencies. And this is one relevant aspect also in the standard, and the expert advice of the Article 31 group of experts in Europe has proposed to have in the directive this kind of training in the directive, ensuring this training in the directive. But unfortunately, the final version of the directive have encouraged the introduction and has been not taken, or there was not enough agreement between the member states to ensure finally to do this kind of training as mandatory in the medical schools. The communication of the risk is also relevant. The WHO has done publications highlighting the importance to communicate not only the risk of the radiation, also the benefits for this information in the case of the patients, especially for pediatrics. And this information should be part of the training. And as a summary, I would like to say that education and training should be one of the priorities in the radiation protection in medicine. And this training should include also information for patients. And should include this information or this education at the medical schools and dental schools. The justification and optimization, especially for the new technologies, and considering the integrated protection of the patient and the staff. In the case of medicine, this kind of interaction and these kinds of integrated approach is relevant. And finally, the coming document of the ethical aspect should also take into account the respect of the autonomy of the patients when patients accept some kind of additional risk to have one radiological examination and to refine probably the criteria for optimization, for justification in these cases. And thank you very much for your attention.